Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia is the most frequent and important drug-induced type of thrombocytopenia. In response to heparin, two distinct types of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia can occur, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 has non-immunologic mechanism. This type of thrombocytopenia occurs due to direct interaction of heparin with circulating platelets that cause platelet sequestration that results in thrombocytopenia. This type of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia occurs within the first 2 days after heparin injection and develops in approximately 10% of patients. First of all, it causes only mild thrombocytopenia. Typically, platelets remain greater than 100. Also, after heparin withdrawn, platelets return to normal levels in 4 days. Also, this type of thrombocytopenia has no associated risk of thrombosis. So, the most important feature is that this type of thrombocytopenia is not dangerous. And because of such mild presentation, this type does not require a lab test to diagnose. In contrast to this, type 2 has immune mechanism and occurs less frequently. Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2 occurs due to antibodies to platelet factor 4 in complex with heparin. Type 2 develops within 5 to 10 days after heparin injection, and it causes severe decrease in platelet count. Platelets usually drop more than 50% from baseline. And also, type 2 has high risk of thrombosis, so the clinical presentation in this case is much more severe. Also, high-yield concept is that in patients previously exposed to heparin, type 2 manifests sooner. So, type 2 is caused by antibodies to complex of heparin and platelet factor 4. And this interaction results in formation of heparin-platelet factor 4 antibody complex, which is the major pathogenic factor. So, to explain the pathogenesis, first of all, we have to know how exactly this complex is formed. To explain this, recall that the inner lining of the blood vessel wall is formed by endothelial cells, and endothelial cells on their surface have glycosaminoglycans that permit some molecules as antithrombin to bind to endothelial cell's surface. And the logic there is that antithrombin molecules create local antithrombotic environment that prevents any thrombus formation. Platelet factor 4, also known as chemokin CXCl4, is small positively charged molecule that is stored in alpha granules of platelets. And for example, when some damage to the blood vessel wall occurs, endothelial injury induces activation of platelets, and with activation, platelets release platelet factor 4 into the circulation. And in the circulation, platelet factor 4 binds to glycosaminoglycans on endothelial cells, and by this binding, platelet factor 4 displays antithrombin, thereby creating local prothrombotic environment that accelerates thrombus formation and thereby helps to repair blood vessel wall. With heparin infusion, once negatively charged heparin appears in the blood, it binds to positively charged platelet factor 4. Because heparin has high affinity for platelet factor 4 compared to any other glycosaminoglycans, heparin takes away platelet factor 4 from endothelial cells, with formation of heparin platelets 4 complex in the circulation. Very important to know that once heparin binds to platelets factor 4, it induces conformational changes in platelets factor 4, and this results in creation of a totally new for immune system protein, so-called neoantigen. Because everything which is new by immune system recognizes foreign substance, this complex is highly immunogenic. And when some of these complexes are taken up by antigen-presenting cells as macrophages, once macrophage presents this newly formed heparin-platelet 4 complex to T helpers, they recognize it as antigen and stimulate B cells to produce antibodies against heparin-platelet 4 complex, most frequently immunoglobulin G. And once this immunoglobulin G antibodies binds to heparin-platelet 4 complex, together they form heparin-platelet 4 immunoglobulin G multimolecular immunogenic complex, and exact formation of this complex is the central event in heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2. So, a brief review. After heparin injection, heparin binds to platelet factor 4 and form heparin-platelet 4 complex, and this complex provokes immune response that results in production of immunoglobulin G, with subsequent formation of heparin-platelet 4 immunoglobulin G complex. So why is this complex so dangerous? First of all, this complex binds to the specific platelet receptor called Fc gamma 2a receptor and activates it. Activation of this receptor activates platelets, and with activation platelets aggregate and also they degranulate. They immediately release procoagulant microparticles in very high quantity. For example, one of them are alpha granules, which are extremely prothrombotic particles, and recalls that platelets factor IV contained exactly in alpha granules. So it creates a vicious cycle where immunogenic complexes stimulate platelets factor IV secretion, and in turn platelets factor IV molecules provoke formation of a new immunogenic complexes. Antigen antibody complexes bind also to Fc gamma 2a receptor on monocytes. In response to this, monocytes increase expression of tissue factor in their surface, and this results in increase in production of monocyte-derived thrombin. And increase in thrombin concentration activates protease activator receptor 1, which serves as signal for platelets activation. Basically, monocytes transactivate platelets. Also, antigen-antibody complexes directly activate endothelial cells. They stimulate production of adhesion molecules such as P and D selectants, and also they induce secretion of von Willebrand factor, thereby creating even more prothrombotic environment. The combination of direct platelets activation, transactivation of platelets by monocytes, and procoagulant stimuli by endothelial cells induce strong local procoagulant state inside the blood vessel. So heparin platelet 4 immunoglobulin G complexes create local prothrombotic environment that results in very high risk of thrombus formation. In fact, the risk of arterial and venous thrombosis as high as 50%. Most commonly venous thrombosis occurs, and the most common sites are leg veins, cardiac vessels, and the skin at the site of heparin injection. Also, activated platelets that have on their surface antigen-antibody complexes are rapidly cleared from the blood by a reticular endothelial system, primarily by the spleen, and this results in thrombocytopenia. Also, there are some risk factors that predispose to heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2. Because platelets release platelet factor 4 in activated state, the higher the extent and duration of platelets activation, the higher the plasma level of platelets 4. So, in conditions when due to the vascular injury, platelets are generally overactivated, as in inflammatory or infectious disease, diabetes, atherosclerosis, or due to traumatic medical procedures, in such conditions, the level of platelets factor 4 in the circulation increase, and the higher the level of platelets factor 4, the higher the probability of formation of immunogenic platelets factor 4 heparin complexes. Also important that heparin affinity for platelets factor 4 depends on molecular weight, chain lengths, and degree of sulfation. Because of that, different heparins have different incidence of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. As we see, unfractionated heparin has the highest risk of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2. And now, very important concept. As we see, type 2 caused by formation of antibodies that activate platelets, and formation of antibodies takes time. So, because of that, full immunogenic response occurs within 5 to 10 days. But what if antibodies are already formed? In this case, immunogenic response occurs within 1 day, and is exactly the reason why in patients with heparin exposure in previous 100 days, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia develops within 24 hours after heparin injection, because these patients already have circulating immunoglobulin G antibodies against heparin platelets 4 complexes. So what are the treatment options? First of all is discontinuation of heparin. We try to remove the provoking factor as soon as possible. And as we see, the major problem here is local procoagulative state that creates high risk of thrombosis. So in order to correct this, intravenous injection of direct thrombin inhibitors prescribed, as ergatroban, danaparoid, and lapirudin. And when acute phase of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2 finished, and platelets count become greater than 150, instead of heparin, patients are switched to vitamin K antagonist, but only after platelets count normalize, which is a sign that acute phase is gone, thereby heparin-induced thrombocytopenia hypercoagulation decreased. And it's very important concept because initially warfarin induced hypercoagulation due to the transient protein C depletion, and hypercoagulation created by heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2 combined with warfarin-induced hypercoagulation create even higher risk of thrombosis and warfarin-induced skin necrosis. Also, the gold standard in diagnosis of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2 is serotonin release assay. And very important concept is that direct thrombin inhibitors must be injected even before any diagnostic procedure, because it's life-threatening condition. So in case of type 2, initially we treat and then we diagnose, and it's very high yield concept for examination purposes.